Imagine walking into your workplace, and every 2 weeks, there's something different happening around you, and you're doing something different. One day, you're building an autonomous vehicle. 2 weeks later, you're designing some Avion couture. And 2 weeks later, you're making an interactive music video. Now hold that thought for a second. Shinryo Suzuki, a teacher of Zen Buddhism, describes this mindset of radical openness as a beginner's mind, stating, "In the beginner's mind, there are many possibilities. In the expert's mind, there are a few." And I thought, this is an interesting way to approach creativity and innovation, from this simple notion of acquiring a beginner's mind. So let's go back to that scenario I asked you to imagine. Well, that's actually my real life at NewView. And in a nutshell, NewView is a full-time innovation studio for middle and high school students that is ever-evolving. But I was curious, in this ever-evolving studio, what were we doing to actually nurture this beginner's mind? And that search led me to three discoveries, which I want to share with you today. Three things which have allowed myself, our students, and our coaches to constantly reinvent ourselves, acquire this beginner's mind, and ultimately be more creative. My first discovery is about the power of mixing. I'm thinking maybe in a past life I was possibly a chemist, because I love this notion of mixing elements that have historically existed in different domains. And at NewView, we kind of have our own unique formula for this mixing. First, we mix people. There's a Zen notion of bringing together experts and neophytes, combining people who know too much with people who know too little. And that's exactly what we do at NewView. We bring together professionals and middle and high school students, and they work together on coming up with really experimental ideas. The goal is to really foster this creative tension between massive expertise and the ability to see with fresh eyes. The second part of this mixing is about mixing themes to create really unique experiences. And we do this by creating a theme for every one of our trimesters, which guides our two-week-long studios. This past summer, our theme was superheroes, and we'd wanted to do a fashion studio, so we decided to merge the two and make a super fashion studio. And to make it a little bit more interesting, we brought two outside collaborators. One was the Hilo Tech Group at the MIT Media Lab to bring in technology in an interesting way, and the second was the Merging Trends show at Boston Fashion Week to take this grand experiment onto the high fashion runway. So suddenly, we had this interesting mixture of superheroes, computational design, digital fabrication, and high fashion, which forced everyone to see with a new fresh pair of eyes and really encouraged this cross-pollination of ideas. Our superhero collection made its debut at Boston Fashion Week, and it was a big hit, and all of our young designers got to attend the show. Our youngest designer was a 12-year-old boy named Max, who designed the Super Max outfit, and the first picture that he posted on his Facebook page was surprisingly not his photograph of the Super Max outfit on the runway, a picture of him sandwiched between the two beauty queens, Miss New Hampshire and Miss Maine. And if you've ever wondered what's on a 12-year-old's mind, now you know. The third part of this mixing involves tinkering, or breaking and making, as I like to call it. At NewView, we really encourage students to repurpose and reuse what others have done and really build upon that, while really embracing collaboration and open source technologies as an essential part of the creative process. One such project is called the Music Box, which is an interactive multiplayer musical instrument made of 6 infrared distance sensors. So you place your hand above a sensor and you get a certain audio output and a lighting effect. Change your hand and you get another audio output and lighting effect. This project went through multiple iterations with almost 5 different groups of students working on this project over 5 different trimesters. My second big discovery is what makes the heart of a beginner. Edith Ackerman, who's a scientist and a psychologist, describes the essential ingredients of a beginner, being part trickster, part craftsman, and part poet. And really, I've seen some of the most creative students really embody these three. And we actually did a quantified self studio. And there was a group of students who was really interested in this exploring polyphasic sleep, which is basically sleeping for short periods of time, multiple times a day, in its most extreme states, 20 minutes every 4 hours. These students were really, really interested, and they went ahead and they arrived the second day with their sleeping bags, pillows in hand, and their pajamas ready for this 2-week experiment. So you can see the team of students first day looking pretty optimistic. And then by day 5, you can see the exhaustion kicking in. But being a trickster means that you really have this disruptive imagination, which is at the heart of the creative process. And you're constantly questioning the establishment. And like tricksters, these students made this experiment work. They set up a sleep station in the back exit hallway of our studio, and they made the experiment work. And like modern day craftsmen, they kept detailed accounts of the effects and tracked their experiments. They used a Zio, which was a sleep monitor, to monitor their sleep patterns over the two-week period. They also tested their changing mood conditions over the 2 weeks, as well as a reaction test to change how their moods were changing over the period of time. And they compared this data to one another and along the 2 weeks period. And like modern day poets, they created a blog where they uploaded daily video blogs and all of their data and really broadcast their story to the world. My third discovery is about this concept of not two, not one, but both two in one, or opposing the dualities that make up a beginner's mind. For me, this has meant looking at two opposing ideas as two sides of the same coin, so they almost possess a oneness. And this has really guided my life and my learnings. And I see this concept transcend into my work at NewView. Firstly, we really believe that both the process matters and the product matters. We tell the students every day, don't get too attached to what you've done, just reflect on it and create something new. And for me, this actually means that by virtue of working on it day to day, you accept the failures, hoping to actually have a better product at the end of the day. My second part of this not two, not one concept is about learning how to be mindful or looking at things afresh when the mind naturally wants to head in a direction of mindlessness or relying on our habits. And what this has meant is our first studio that we had, which is a nanotechnology studio, was a big failure because we planned every ounce of it. There was no original thought, no creative thinking. By the end of the trimester, we invited the same coach to come and teach another studio, which was called the Intentional Energy Studio. This time, we scrapped the syllabus, we scrapped all the daily activities, there was no defined project. And why? Because the students were going to come up with the final project. And what happened was that the students came up with this fantastical idea to build an intergalactic, pedal-powered juicer, laser light show, and sound system. Pretty amazing. And within 2 weeks, they took that idea and made it a reality, which is what you see in this picture. And what I realized that in order to be mindful, a lot of the work had to be left undefined, open to the future, so that every student and every one of us could be and acquire a beginner's mind and be a creator. The final part of this not two, not one philosophy is really embracing fiction and reality. I've learned to live in this interesting zone of suspended belief where I never say no to an idea, especially the crazy ones. The flight simulator studio began, as most studios do, with this nebulous idea to create a virtual flight simulator. And by the end of the 2 weeks, this is what was there. The students had built both a physical and virtual flying game experience. And this is one of our students, Harper, who's testing out the flight simulator. And what you don't see is there's a huge projection of this virtual gaming environment. All of this was done within 2 weeks. Embracing fiction and reality means letting go of your old stories and creating new magical ones. And this is what we do every 2 weeks. Every 2 weeks, we see our studio changing with new coaches, new studio topics, and new energy. And we're constantly evolving the way that we live, play, work, and learn together. And in some ways, our studio is not much different a year ago, a place under construction. And in some ways, our studio is still a place that's in progress, under construction, a prototype of the school of the future. Shinryo Suzuki tells a story of a person walking in dew for a while. And while she's walking in the dew, she doesn't notice that she's getting wet. But upon reaching her destination, she realizes that she's soaking wet. In some ways, acquiring a beginner's mind happens like this, little by little, not all at once, yet it's highly transformative.